Greetings to all of you and welcome to our worship service on this February 12th, 2023. We hope that indeed you might be blessed in some maybe unexpected way. The title of the sermon is Unexpected Blessings, and we're looking at Matthew, the 5th chapter. Before we receive that message, go with me, let us circle around the piano and be blessed by the marvelous music of Larry Loeber.
Reading today starts with Matthew in the 5th chapter, and it starts with the first verse. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
What do you think about when I say the word bitter? Do you know someone who has the right to be bitter? Do you know some people that are just bitter for no apparent reason at all? But I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about those who are bitter, who have the right to be bitter. I think of the opera singer who was not accepted in this country and had to start in another country. She had a professional life finally that was full of all kinds of despair. In her personal life, she had tragedy. Two of her children were born to her who were physically challenged. And in order to escape New York City, she decided at some time, along with her family, to build a house in Martha's Vineyard. This is after she gained some kind of acceptance and fame. And that house in Martha's Vineyard went burned to the ground. Plenty of room for bitterness, anger, resentment on all sides, not accepted, not paid attention to, children with special needs, and then your house going to the ground. She could have been a victim. She had plenty to gripe about. We find none of this in her. Her friends call her Bubbles. We call her the operatic star Beverly Sills. Mike Wallace was interviewing her one time, calling her Bubbles. Why is it that they call you Bubbles in the midst of all these tragedies? She said, "One day I chose to be cheerful. Years ago, I realized I had little or no choice about success, circumstances, or even happiness itself. But I knew I could choose to be cheerful." Beverly Sills. Our text today has the word in Greek, makarios, blessed, happy, joyful, fortunate, cheerful are you. It says it 9 times in this text, if we were to go farther than just 2 verses. It speaks of the godly joy given by God right in the middle of things being just the way they are rather than the way you want them to be. Who of us cannot speak of those times in our lives where we wish for things to be different than what they are? But it's right in the middle of that that the New Testament speaks of joy. We know that happiness is something you never get when seeking it directly. Golly, Nads, it'd be good if we get that across to parents. How many times did parents come to me and talk about their kids? All I want is for my children to be happy. Parents never say that to your kids because it's in the harder things that make them the more mature persons that they are. Don't say that. You will be bringing up frustrated kids who think they can get happiness by seeking it. What has seeking happiness gotten us? People, you might want to just think about this for the rest of the afternoon. We are indeed the wealthiest nation in the world. We are the wealthiest and most unhappy people in the world. Go figure. You might want to look up some of those who are the happiest, like in Scandinavia and other countries. Countries like I visited in Vietnam, Cambodia, some of the happiest people I've ever seen who basically have nothing. But that's for your own study. Go take a look. But be haunted by the fact that we have more than anyone and we also have more unhappiness. Let me talk about the choice that stands before us. There was a man who was teaching religion in the state of Washington, driving his van one night on the freeway. They were struck by a truck. His wife, his mother, his daughter were wiped out in an accident. They were all killed. People said to him, Mr. Religious Teacher, don't you ever say, why me? And he would always say to them, well, why not me? He knew that God doesn't go around the world with his hand on steering wheels and knives and guns. He knows that God goes around the world willing to pick up the pieces of our shattered lives and walk with us until the day God makes all things new. You know, the deep joy that's talked about in the New Testament is either a result of our circumstances or a choice, no matter what happens to us. With the Apostle Paul, it was always a deep joy right in the middle of being in prison, beaten, rejected by everyone that came in his path. There's a man by the name of Tim Hansel. He's a Christian writer. He had a terrible fall one time, and the result was it was totally painful for him to walk, just simple walking. And one more doctor came to him and said something that totally changed his life. He wanted to get rid of this pain, this chronic pain. You know, because I've said way too many times, you know, pain's no darn good at all. And it can get in the way of us being able to concentrate on other things, from reading a book to having a good walk. But one doctor changed his life. He said to him, there's nothing we can do to eliminate your pain. There is something you can do. And the guy very anxiously said to him, he said, well, what? What can I do? And the doctor said, live. Live. Hansel said something in that flipped on a light. He said, I chose doom because I couldn't change my circumstances. I discovered that I could find joy right in the middle of my circumstances, which were often painful. Hansel said, I ran out of the hospital after talking to that doctor, and I walked all the way back to my office, and I haven't stopped since. And the book he wrote is entitled, You Gotta Keep Dancing. You Gotta Keep Dancing. It was in the book of Deuteronomy. These words that we could well memorize, as identified as words from God. I place before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life, so that you and your children will live. How many people within earshot of my voice right now are one decision away from joy, just like Tim? Abraham Lincoln is such an amazing figure for all of us. We knew that he was a man of melancholy. I got to tell you, I'm sure he was a man of deep grief, not to mention the woman that he was about to marry and died, and he sat out there by her grave for days, and there were days that he just wanted to die himself, and somehow got up and kept going and brought his blessings to a nation that needed him badly. He was depressed. He had melancholy. But later on in his life, he would say, I have determined that people will be about as happy as they make up their mind to be. The problem with that statement is its profound simplicity. And in the life of the church, I found that to be profoundly true. There's a second thing here, and that would be the disclaimers. Many tell you to choose joy. The Dale Carnegie course, Norman Vincent Peale, Zig Ziglar, Robert Schuller, and many others that have followed. Robert Schuller had what he called in the text before us, he called them the Be Happy Attitudes. Well, yeah, there's a little bit more to be said, but that's for another time. They suggest that the Beatitudes are a different way of looking at life. Is this a mental trick? There's no mental gymnastics here. The Beatitudes deal with our heart and not our head. Our head would say, oh, God, this is terrible. I just can't go on anymore. The Beatitudes talk soul and not exterior systems. Yes, as we think, so we are, says the Bible. But if the change is just left to the mind, it won't last. Beatitudes talk of a heart change. I remember Mother Teresa, before she started her ministry there in Calcutta. She's on the street. Remember, her ministry was to simply be with people who were dying. It wasn't curing them, anything, taking them to the hospital, anything. It was to be with them, because she said loneliness is the worst of things to happen to us in life. And so there was a man from Britain who was making a film of her. And she is standing there by this man dying. And he goes, my God, this is just awful. Do you do this all the time? She said, yes, I do. Isn't it a privilege? Isn't it a privilege for us to be with this man and put aside his loneliness at the time of his death? No mental gymnastics. That is what love is trained to see. There's a third thing here, and that's the power of the Beatitudes. Those inside the faith find great power in them. I remember that I was conducting with the Roman Catholic Church a community building workshop, and there was a priest who had announced, he said, you know, I'm about to celebrate 50 years in ministry. And he got to talking about that a little bit. And then in the second day that we were together, this man broke into tears at one time for saying of his Roman Catholic Church, I must say also every Protestant church, he said, the problem with the church is that we've forgotten Matthew 5. We have forgotten Matthew 5. We are hopelessly lost as a church because we have forgotten Matthew 5. And he's right. And that includes us to this day. You know, Richard Rohr says, there's only one thing for the church to be about. He has this vision for us, that when we gather every Sunday, before we leave, the main questions as the church gathers together, how can we be better at loving people, including enemies? How can we be better at forgiveness? How can you, Dick, be better at compassion? How can you be better at inclusivity of the entire human family? Those of us inside the church should be centering on those questions alone, says Richard Rohr. Now, there are those outside the faith that have comments about the Beatitudes. Kurt Vonnegut, he says he's a man without a country, a spiritual country. He says, I think it's an interesting way he said, I don't think I believe in God. Let's call him a truthful agnostic. But he said he does believe in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, and I'm quoting him now, the words of Jesus in the Beatitudes are so beautiful and true that it really doesn't matter to him, to Vonnegut, who Jesus is. His ideas ring true even to the most hardened atheist, end of quote. Vonnegut again said this, for some reason, the most vocal Christians among us never mention the Beatitudes. But often with tears in their eyes, they demand that the Ten Commandments be posted in public buildings. It's demanded by people who cannot name more than one of the Ten Commandments that they want to give their life to. I always thought that I'm going to really honor any church that has the Beatitudes out in front. And lo and behold, I was on a retreat down in Florida, and I was walking by a Roman Catholic church, and lo and behold, it wasn't the Ten Commandments out there, it was the Beatitudes. And I said, this has got to be a good church, the church I've been looking for a long period of time that will put those in front of the church rather than the Ten Commandments. And of course, the Ten Commandments are Moses and not Jesus, and we know that. I haven't heard one of those who demand those Ten Commandments demand at the same time the Sermon on the Mount with the Beatitudes. Haven't heard that any time. How blessed are the merciful. Vonnegut says, those would be good words to put in front of the courtroom, in front of the courthouse. How about this, he said, blessed are the peacemakers. Why don't we put that in front of the Pentagon? Wouldn't that be a good idea? He said, I think it would be a good idea. The voice of culture is so loud that we need to develop an inner ear. Blessed are the merciful, unconditional love. Blessed are the pure in heart, undiluted morals. Blessed are the peacemakers, undying influence. Blessed are those persecuted for God's sake, unquenchable commitment. May God bless us with an ability to hear and then act on the words of Jesus in our time. Never has this world needed those words and actions more than now. May the peace of God be with you on that path. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Eternal God, we praise you for your constant presence of grace, love, and companionship that often get drowned out by the voices around us. Newspapers, television newscasts, and media all report the troubled happenings in our world. War and strife seem to be the order of the day, and lack of health abounds in those we love and care for. Some days it feels like the world is going to pieces with chaos everywhere. God, calm our spirits. Help us to focus on the love you have given to us in Jesus Christ. Remind us again that his healing mercies extend to us this day as surely as they did to the people of long ago. Help us to remember that you are no more present to us today than you were with the men and women of old. We've gathered on this day to hear your word, to be forgiven and healed, to find ways in which we may serve you in peace. We now lift up to you the names we have brought to the service of worship. You know our needs and concerns before our voices can even frame them. For we dare to pray all these things in the name of the one who taught disciples, and so we pray the same. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
And now may the peace of God that passes all of our understanding and our best efforts keep our hearts and our lives within the power and scope of His love. Amen.